You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
Hi, I'm Jay Farner, CEO of Quicken Loans, America's largest mortgage lender. Spring will be here soon, so if buying a new home is on your to-do list, right now is the time to call Quicken Loans. Learn about which mortgage options make sense for you and get a jump on your competition. With our exclusive Rate Shield approval, the low rate you lock today is protected for up to 90 days while you shop for your new home. With a Rate Shield approval, if rates go up, your low rate stays locked. But if rates go down, you get that new, even lower rate. Either way, you win. Talk to us today at 800-QUICKEN or go to rocketmortgage.com to take advantage. Here's another great reason to work with us. For a record 9 years in a row, J.D. Power has ranked Quicken Loans highest in the nation in customer satisfaction for primary mortgage origination. Again, to lock in today's low mortgage interest rate and get the security of our exclusive Rate Shield approval, call us today at 800-QUICKEN or go to rocketmortgage.com.
For J.D. Power award information, visit jdpower.com. Rate Shield approval only valid on certain 30-year fixed rate loans. Call for cost information and conditions. Equal housing lender. License in all 50 states. NMLS number 3030.
Hi, welcome to the Subway ad for the new Sesame Ginger Glazed Chicken Signature Wrap. How would you like it?
I'll take a...
Sports announcer at home?
Yeah, how'd you...
We just know.
My wife picks up the new signature wrap. It's got double the rotisserie-style chicken mixed with a sesame ginger glaze. She appears annoyed at me, but she shrugs it off. Those sweet and savory flavors are calling her name. She lifts the wrap and... She takes the bite! Incredible! And now she's closing the door on my... Subway, make it what you want.
Limited time only at participating restaurants. Double meat basement, average 6-inch sub.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.
This is Derek's O'Reilly Auto Parts story.
After the third time jump-starting my car, I finally realized my battery was dying. So I stopped by O'Reilly to have it checked. They tested it right there in the parking lot. It was bad, real bad. But they helped me find the right battery for my car and even installed it for free. Now my car starts like new.
Oh, 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 O'Reilly Auto Parts.
Today, this breakfast isn't just breakfast. It might be the first McDonald's breakfast you're having at McDonald's again. This lunch might be a weekly tradition you hadn't had in weeks. And this dinner might be the first one you bought for not just you in a while. Whatever this order is for you, McDonald's will be here to take it.
Get more of the chicken you love with a delicious McChicken sandwich for $1. And for an extra buck, add a refreshing Dr. Pepper. Dining rooms are starting to reopen in certain communities at participating McDonald's. Cannot be combined with any other offer or combo meal.
The following program contains coarse language and adult themes. Listener discretion is advised.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy.
To achieving the goal before this decade is out of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the earth.
We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other thing. Not because they are easy, but because they are hard.
Freedom is never more than one generation away from extinction. We didn't pass it on to our children in the bloodstream. The only way they can inherit the freedom we have known is if we fight for it, protect it, defend it, and then hand it to them with the well-taught lessons of how they in their lifetime must do the same.
To think, all throughout history, there have been presidential orators such as those we use to open the show, and we get... That's all, folks. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Jen and Rick Show. I'm Rick. She's Jen. Good evening, Jen. How are you?
I'm doing fine. How are you?
It still trips me out to think that, you know, I'm finally doing this for a living, and instead of getting to talk about, like, awesome presidents like Reagan... And even Kennedy, I get to talk about sleep-deprived, pudding-brained Porky Pig.
Joe Biden?
Porky Pig. I just swear to God. I mean, if they're going to go with the stutter analogy, which is how everybody keeps saying it, I'm just going to start calling him Porky Pig, but that's not a stutter. I mean, Donald Trump just put out a political ad again today that proves that Joe Biden should be arrested for elder abuse. And yet, this is the timeline we find ourselves in. CERN! Oh, sorry. That's another show. My bad.
Yeah, I'm starting to really feel, you know, I always have, and I don't feel sorry for Biden, the person that, you know, he was, because he has wreaked havoc on our Republic for the better part of 50 years, and has always been unapologetically awful throughout his tenure in Congress. But I am starting to feel for the elder thing even more now, going through a situation with my husband's mother where she's being taken advantage of by my sister-in-law. And so it's like, she's not competent enough to be able to make these decisions. And even though she can walk and talk and she can take her own showers and she can seem fine if you meet her out at a restaurant or whatever, you know, she can go to the store with you, but she also has declined mentally to such a degree that she goes through very confused bouts. She has kind of all the hallmark signs, and she's officially been diagnosed with Alzheimer's. So, but just to see it, you can get her to talk and repeat things. Like, you can get her to answer questions in a pretty specific way. But she's not competent. She's not there. And it's so sad to see how what we're having to try to do now, which is protect her from, you know, people that take advantage of that. And unfortunately, I think that as much as I despise his entire career, I do feel for the fact that an old man is being treated and propped up this way. I think it's disgusting.
Yeah, I mean, I don't like Joe Biden the man any more than I really much care for Donald Trump the man. But the way Biden's family is treating him just makes me angry, because this guy should have been just let to retire forever ago. I mean, I'm not even talking about within – I mean, granted, it's really been bad within the last 4 years, but he should have just, you know – been like, look, dude, you've been in the Senate for forever. Just go enjoy time with your grandkids. Something, anything. I mean,
go be throwing, you know, skipping rocks on the pond and watching the duck, feeding bread to the ducks. I mean, whatever it is, like, and that's the thing too, is like, it's no secret, anybody that's followed me on Twitter for a long time and been in any sort of groups with me, that my mother-in-law and I did not have the best relationship. She was not a fan of me or my marriage overall. And so that's a difficult thing that I dealt with, but that's not who she is anymore. And she deserves to be cared for with dignity and grace to live out the rest of her life. Even if we disagreed and didn't like each other when she was of sound mind. But I think most human beings deserve that. I fall a little bit short of every, because there are people, you know, in this world that are absolutely horrific human beings that don't deserve to breathe another breath. But but that's just a personal opinion of mine. I will say that it was interesting. I don't know if you know, I was kind of thinking of, that made me think of like dictators and stuff. And I was going to say, tell you a funny little story before we got into stuff today. But, you know, they played this opening MLB game in South Korea. Mm-hmm. And so I'm driving my kid to school and it's like the bottom of the seventh. And so it's on. And he's like, oh yeah, no. And that's in South Korea. And he's like, that's not the bad one, right? said, no, North Korea is the bad one. And he's like, okay, that's what I thought. And then he said, and why are they bad? They're just like mean to people. So we kind of went through stuff. And then I said, you know, you can't say like, for instance, like in that country, you wouldn't be able to say, you know, back when Trump was president, you know, how people were really mad at President Trump. You wouldn't be able to say those things out loud. And he goes, and I said, and you wouldn't be able to say that Biden is. And he goes, dumb.
See, I'm telling you, smart kid. You're
I was like, oh, let's go. But I was like, yes, that too. But we wouldn't be able to talk about, we wouldn't be able to say that we didn't like something about this country. And so we kind of had a little mini conversation about authoritarianism, true fascism, and a little hint of communism with the whole everybody's poor and everybody has to do these things and no one gets to choose their own lives. And he was like, that's really sad and that's not fair. That's not right for people. And I said, it certainly is not, which is why we support freedom. So that was just a neat little mini lesson on, you know, kind of democratic principles, definitely a little bit of free speech, and then the difference between our very, very vast political ideologies. So kind of fun. But also, thank you for presenting that topic for a ride to school, Major League Baseball. What a weird one I didn't expect to have.
I was kind of, I'm not going to lie, I was kind of weirded out when I heard that they were doing like the season opener was being played in North Korea and South Korea. I was like, wait, what? And then I was like, yeah, I guess they are trying to make us all one big happy world now. So I guess I shouldn't be that surprised.
But it's also funny because on the one hand, like the Major League Baseball is like, okay, let's make it more enjoyable and likable for fans. Let's get more eyeballs on the sport, yada, yada, yada. And then on the other hand, they're like, you know what? You know what'll do the trick? Let's kick off the season in the middle of the night in America. But like it. But no, the game won't be in America. No, 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 you got it all wrong. It's going to actually be in a different country. And we're going to take two teams that have, you know, okay fan bases, but have been pretty fickle the last decade or so. And then we're going to have this, but we're going to do it in South Korea. Yeah, no, not in America. But it's going to be American time. It's going to be like 3:00 in the morning. So don't you think that'll bring viewers? That'll be a hit, right? Total hit.
Well, I mean, you know, the only people that probably weren't complaining were the Night Owls that finally got to listen to a baseball game that they weren't trying to sleep through.
Live, right. They're like, oh, thank God, this is actually happening live. I don't have to listen to a recording or watch a DVR.
Nobody can ruin it by giving me the score before I finally get to watch it. That's one of the things I used to hate about watching our working nights, because I would be sleeping and the games and everything would be on. And like, I mean, and we're talking like ex-wife used to have like full on house parties with OU games. And I would still, you know, especially on the early games, which aren't as often as they used to be, I would still be trying to sleep. And then I would get up and have the game DVR'd. And so I'd come out just as everybody was starting to, you know, party was wrapping up. Everybody was getting ready to leave just so I could at least say hi to everybody. Cause by the time I watched the game, I was going to have to get ready for work. And without fail, someone would ruin it for me every single time.
Yeah.
I'm like, I hate you people. Yep. You fucking daywalkers. You make me so mad.
There are times where even just like we're at something else, so we can't be watching, you know, watching on TV or listening on the radio or whatever. And I will straight up silence my phone. I will turn off notifications from like any thread or person that I think might text me about it. Like I will go try to go as dark as possible so that I don't get it spoiled. But yeah, it's difficult. It's very difficult for sure.
Yeah, it's just one of those weird little things. But yeah, I heard about that yesterday and I'm like, wait, so the game, it's going to be here, but it's going to be on at like 3 a.m. I said, I know a lot of vampires that are going to be happy. I won't be one of them because I have, now granted, for the last several years, I've been working day shift. So I did eventually try to get my clock adjusted, but it never really works. So most of the time I was usually falling asleep by about 1, 2, 3 a.m. and then usually had to be up by like 6 or 7 anyway to start getting to be out the door and go to work. And so now that I'm semi-retired, and you know this, I had this great plan when I first retired. Oh, I'm going to go back to doing a morning show again and then get myself up at like 4, do the prep work, have the show done by 8 or 9, you know, hit the ground running, do my writing, and then probably take a nap. And then that worked for like 2 weeks. And then my body was like, hey, you work nights for like 20 years, bro.
Yeah, this is not what you do.
You work nights for like 20 years, bro. You were on day shift for like 10. We win. So everything started reverting. But the, and then so the and then originally and then once I started changing around, I was like, you know what? I'll just write at night. But then because I'm not 30 years old anymore, even though I'm not awake, my brain is turning to mush by like midnight, 1 o'clock in the morning. So I can't write anymore because I'll sit at the computer and I'll try to make sentences that make sense. And it looks like I have dyslexia along with trying to type in Spanish. And I'm just like, yeah, nope, I'll have to write another day. So I'm finding all of these things that I thought were going to be super simple that are not super simple because my body's like, just kidding. You get in.
Yeah.
And so the insomnia is back too, which is always fun. So 2 or 3 nights out of the week now, I'm just like, yeah, no, I'll try to go to bed early. And every time I say that sentence, so I don't really say it anymore, I'm up till 5, 6, 7 in the morning. And then I finally close my eyes till like 10. And then I'm like, okay, now I have to get up. And then I'm drinking coffee for 2 hours just so I can be conscious. But yeah, so trying to be self-employed when you have believe it or not, I have been diagnosed with something that I didn't even know was a thing. But they have this new thing called shift work disorder. So if you're somebody whose shift varied a lot, or you were on one shift for a long time and then you tried to change over to another one, your body's rhythms just get screwed. And you never apparently really recover from it. So they've created this new syndrome called shift work disorder. And apparently I have that, according to my doctor. Like, yeah, you're describing shift work disorder. And I'm like, that sounds like something somebody fucking made up. What are you talking about? But apparently it's been a thing for like...
You're like, that sounds made up.
But apparently it's been a thing for like over a decade now. I'm like, what is this?
I'd probably have it too. I'm naturally a night owl anyways, but then obviously like running events and restaurants and bars and having even like 24-hour shifts and still like having to have like all these spurts of where like, yeah, you don't get home until like 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning, but then sometimes you have to be open, you know, you're opening at 8 or at 9 or something like that. And so then you have to be bright-eyed and bushy-tailed for the day shift. And then you might get like a night off or something and then go back to going in at 4 and not being done till 5. And like, it's just all over the map and it can be a lot to adjust to. And it's just like, can change from week to week, but generally you're up late, breaking down late. And I already was a night, not that late of a night owl, but I was already a night owl anyways. And I come by, honestly, my parents are, Rex stayed with us and got to see that firsthand, that like they legit stay up to like 1 or 2 a.m. on like any given night. So like people used to bring me home, like home for curfew in high school. And they'd be like, oh my gosh, the lights would be like on downstairs and they could see the TV. And they're like, is your dad waiting up for you? How embarrassing. And I'm like, no, my dad's just up. Like he's finishing catching up on the stock markets for the day and planning out what he's doing tomorrow. And then like, he's catching up on this or that or the other. And no, like he's up. He's probably still doing work on his computer. Like he'd be like, no, he's not waiting for you. And I'm like, no, I'll walk in and he'll probably be like, oh, is it curfew already? Like he won't even be watching the clock. I'm like, I promise. It's not even a big deal, but it's like, oh, that is a problem, though. You can't sneak in. You can't come home, like, wasted or something because he's awake.
My mom never paid enough attention. It didn't matter if she was home or not.
Well, my dad definitely would. I did one time, walk, like, we had gone after, like, a big game or something. We went with a bunch of friends. Like, Taco Cabana was open late. It was open to, like, no, I think it was open 24 hours at that time. So that would be like the spot we'd all go meet and like hang out on the patio and get food and whatever. And like, we had not been able to eat like all afternoon from getting out of school. I think because the game was like out of town, drove to the game or whatever, went to the game, came back. We're too busy socializing and doing whatever we were doing to like eat a hot dog at the game. Came back and this isn't football. I think it was basketball. And came back and I was starving and I like gorged, like completely gorged on Taco C. And got home and like when we're in the truck on the way home, I was like, it was that like so full that like your jeans are like digging into your stomach and you feel like you're gonna pop. So I'd unbutton the top button and like loosen the zipper just a little bit. And I mean, I weighed 80 pounds, like late 90s, early 2000s, like super low rise, skinny tight jeans, like around your butt. They still had flared legs, but they were so tight. Whatever. Anyways, I am, but like not even thinking anything of it, like unbuttoned and unzipped a little bit. And like, so I could breathe on the way home and get dropped off by my boyfriend and walk in the house. And my dad's like, you forgot something. And I was like, no, I was just really full because we ate. Oh, God. And ran upstairs. And I was mortified. My dad thought I was letting this boy get in my pants. And I was absolutely terrified of doing anything below the belt in real life. So it was like, I'm not even lying. Now I'm mortified that you even think I would. And I'm mortified about thinking that I could. No.
I just love how he was like all Liam Neeson about it. Like, hey, you forgot something.
Yeah. It's like, you forgot something. And I was like, oh, I unbuttoned them because we just ate Taco Cabana. And he's like, and I was like, good night. And ran upstairs.
What's worse is the fact that you tried to explain it just made him disbelieve you even more.
No, I don't think so. He knew what a chicken shit I was, but it was hilarious that it was like, oh, this looks really bad. And like, he didn't exactly love my boyfriend. So there's that.
Yeah, well, as a dad, let me explain it. And it's weird because I am a boy dad and a girl dad. It's so much different with girls because we never like their boyfriends. Never.
I don't know. Like, he was fine with others, but this one was a punk, and he really was. And, you know, it's fine. He got out of prison a couple years ago, and I hear he's doing great.
Oh, wow. Jen's boyfriend went to prison.
Yeah.
So there's a whole bad girl side of you we need to get into sometime, apparently. No, I'm just kidding.
Yeah, he really wasn't that bad boy when I dated. I mean, he was like in the like very stereotypical teenager way, but not in reality. I mean, like he went to school. He was star track, star football player, blah, blah, blah. I was captain of the dance team. We were like Mr. and Miss Susie High School. Got grades, like all of that. So he was still, but you know, he drove a Jeep, he drove a Wrangler a little too fast and smoked some weed and, you know, acted like a little punk ass with his music too loud and whatever else. But anyways, but he took a turn for the worse later on and then ended up like that. And my dad's like, I told you so. And I was like, he was not like that when we dated, but whatever, if it makes you feel better. It took losing a sister and like a whole bunch of other effed up shit in his family to make that the case. But anyways,
so
enough about my prison boyfriend.
Well, I mean, we haven't done a show in like what, 2-3 weeks, so we had catching up to do. Anyway, yeah. But yeah, so there's plenty of news. So interesting side note, apparently. Americans are too lazy to work 40 hours a week, so the Democrat-controlled Senate is trying to pass a bill to institute a 32-hour work week with the same pay. So, there's that.
It's insane to me the ways in which they want to control anything like this. And we've seen just how many times, time and time again, it like does not work well, does not result in what they claim it's going to for the populace overall. And yet they still insist, much like everything else with the government, that they can still do it, throw a little more money at it, write another new little, you know, addendum here or there and make it somehow still not work. But they'll keep trying, because eventually they're going to get it right, you know, kind of like, you know, real communism's never been tried.
Yeah, they'll get it right, but how they're going to get
socialism.
How they're going to get it right, though, is they're going to, through these all these public-private partnerships that have sprung up over the last 15 years or so, they're eventually going to wrest control away from everyone and basically start trying to control how we produce, control housing markets, automobiles, all of it. And they're going to be able to tell us where we work, when we work, how we work, where we live, what we wear, and what we drive. And case in point, the O'Biden administration, yes, I said what I said, has now released new EPA mandates that will price us out of gas-powered vehicles by no later than 2035.
Yeah, whatever. It's never going to happen. They can go ahead and say that. It's never going to happen.
We say never, but how many things have we said were never going to happen that are now happening right now as we speak?
Well, what state was it? What state was it that said that by 2030, and that was like 10 years ago, and they've already walked it back to like 2040.
Oh, I know.
There's something that's very recently, a state that had declared that they weren't going to allow it until 2030. They've already walked it back another 10 years.
But yeah, and it may get walked back another few times.
I mean, that's going to be impossible. They also said we weren't going to have any more coal at all, and we've still got plenty of functioning. But they're still making new coal mines and plants. So I just think it's wishful thinking. It makes all the green, you know, all the green climate change freaks like feel good for a little bit, and then they'll eventually quietly like knock it away. Like that's what happens. But I was going to say, too, speaking of them being crazy and controlling, like Merrick Garland in this like Apple antitrust complaint situation, you know, that's going on. So,
go ahead.
Agent Garland is again, just like let them do what they're gonna do, and they're like, no, we must control. And so he must have an Android because his like one of his, he spent an entire paragraph talking about, you know, how Apple makes it hard for the Samsung users and the Android users to integrate with the iPhone users, and they do it on purpose to make them look stupid and feel bad. Like he pretty much says that. He's like, the iPhone user has a green bubble and incorporates limited, you know, the text appears to the iPhone user as a green bubble and incorporates limited functionality. The conversation is not encrypted, videos are pixelated and grainy, and users cannot edit messages or see typing indicators. This signals to users the rival smartphones are lower quality because the experience of messaging friends and family who do not own iPhones is worse. Even though Apple is not the rival, smartphone is the cause of that degraded user experience. So everybody's highlighting that part. The next sentence is the one to me that is batshit. Many non-iPhone users also experience, like he put this in an actual legal complaint. Many non-iPhone users also experience social stigma, exclusion, and blame for breaking chats where other participants own the iPhones. The effect is particularly powerful for certain demographics, like teenagers, where the iPhone share is 85%. Anyways, it's like, so this is actually something that is causing harm to people because of the social stigma, the exclusion, and the blame that they get for their green bubbles. Like, I don't give an F. This is a ridiculous thing for a grown man to put in anything, but especially the Attorney General of our fucking country. Like, what?
I got nothing. I mean, I was a diehard Android guy for years, and the only reason I changed over to Apple was because at the time, my 68-year-old father decided to get rid of his flip phone, and my stepmother, who is significantly younger than him, talked him into getting an Apple smartphone. Well, my stepmom is typically out of the home now taking care of her elderly mother because she lives in the country and they live in the city. So she's there 3-4 nights a week when the other brothers and sisters can't be there. So my dad was constantly calling me and texting me going, I don't understand how to make this thing work. I'm used to a phone where you flip it. So eventually, because I got tired of having to research all of it and not having any way to test the things that he was asking me about because I had an Android, My son also wanted to get an iPhone. So, and he wanted an iPhone 13. Well, we have Cricket, and with Cricket, you can now do the whole, we'll let you have the phone and you tack on an extra 10, 15 bucks a month to your bill. Well, I didn't really want to do that. So I walked in and I looked at the price of the iPhone 13, and then I looked at the price of the iPhone 11, and I'm like, hey, we can get two of these for what they want for one of those, and I have the money to do that. So yep. Let's just do that. So I've had an Apple now for going on, I think it's about 2 years. And I have to admit, once I adjusted, it is a better brand of phone. And I have Android people that are willing to fight me about that now, but it's the truth. But that way, when Dad was like, hey, I don't know how to do this, instead of just Googling it, I could actually Google it and then figure it out on my phone and then, you know, call him back the next day and be like, okay, this is what you need to do. Or if it was something quick, I could just walk him through it real quick. Because it was annoying me, because I'm one of those people, I'm a tech guy. When I got out of wearing a badge and a gun and closed down my security company, thanks to Obama, I got into tech support work, because it was something that I was always good at. One of the degrees I have is in IT work. So it's just something that I've always done. Granted, I'm 51 now and getting out of the loop. So even I start getting more frustrated half the time anymore, since I have a 20-something living in my home who's also very tech-oriented. I'm like, hey, come figure this shit out. So yes, I'm turning into my dad, just so everybody knows. But yes, so I do have an iPhone now. And I was unaware, like, with the differences between, like, texting and stuff. Like, if you have an iPhone and you're texting somebody else with an iPhone, it comes across a certain way and it says iMessage. And then you text somebody with an Android and then the bubble's a different color. And then it's, you know, text message. Or if whoever you're texting that is part of, has an iPhone is off, is out of the iMessage range or whatever, it'll come through as send as a text message. But I don't really understand how that can be like a social stigma, because, oh my God, you have an Android and
it's just the jokes of like that people, like we joke, like my dad has an Android and so we don't include him in the family group chats. Like he's not included because it's obnoxious, because we send all these videos of Ben and my niece and like each other and like whatever, and it screws him up. And then he can't do, like, every time he gets annoyed because every time we're like hearting or liking or laughing at each other's comments on his phone, it doesn't do it on all Androids, but on his phone it comes through as a separate message every time for a notification. So it'll be like, Jennifer liked Brandon's message that said da 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 da.
Yeah, and that's what it used to do on
every single one of them. And when there's his two son-in-laws, his three kids, and his wife on this chat, and then sometimes it's also my cousins. So like he's got three cousins, you know, three nieces and nephews, you know, his son-in-laws and his three kids, and then us on the chat, and we're like, all because instead of just going ha 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 to everything everybody says, we just hit that like, hit that laugh, hit that heart, you know, we've become accustomed to that, just like you do, you know, in DM on Twitter. And it would just be terribly irritating for him. And also, he doesn't really give a shit about half the stuff that we're talking about anyways. He's like, text me the important stuff or your mom will tell me. Like, I don't care. Like, we do a lot of back and forth and, like, gifts and stuff. And my mom loves that and joins in on all the fun. He's like, yeah, I'm cool. Okay, anyways, back to day trading. So, anyway.
You have fun with your gifts. Like, I'm making money.
I get it.
Yeah, your dad's like, you guys have fun with your gifts. I'm over here making money. Leave me out of it.
But I do know that, like, we tease, like, friends and stuff. Like, one of my best friends, like, had been an iPhone user for forever, and she switched to Android. And I was like, you bitch, how dare you? Like, now this is going to screw everything up. And it really doesn't. When you're doing one-on-one, it's not that big of a deal. Like, who cares? But I get it that there's, like, jokes about it. Like, you're the green bubble in our group. Oh, blah, blah, blah. But for him to put that in, you know, to file that as a part of this complaint that's looking into possible antitrust laws against Apple, to put that in there in an entire paragraph talking about the social stigma of the green bubble is why Apple is bad is just absolutely laughable and ridiculous.
One of the headlines I read talked about Apple's green shaming, and I'm like, Apple's against climate change?
I didn't know that was the case, but okay.
It's like, this makes me even happier that I have an iPhone now. But
anyways, whatever. I started smartphones with iPhone just because that's what my boss had, and that's what he wanted me to get. He wanted me to get an iPhone so that I was integrated with him and his wife, and then all of our other bar managers. He paid for all of our phones the first, most of when I was working for him. So he bought me my first iPhone, and I think it was the 3 or the 4. No, it was the 3. Bought me the 3. So I just always use that as a smartphone, but all my tablets have always been Android. So I've experienced both worlds. Like, I like both. I don't really care. The arguments get super intense, and I'm over here going, whatever. But I just found it ridiculous that the attorney general even included anything about that at all and had the gall to sit there and talk about the social stigma as if that was an actual legitimate reason to consider, filing antitrust against Apple. Social stigma of the green bubble Apple's should not play any part shaming. In any of this whatsoever.
Yeah, Apple's green bubble shaming. I will never forget that sentence. I was like, what the hell is that? I don't even...
Like, what?
I was like, wait, what? Speaking of sentences that I will never forget, there's a lawsuit that came out recently that's probably just single-handedly fixed the police department recruitment problem, because I'm pretty sure every hooker in America is making a run to sign up as a cop right now.
Oh, boy. She got $500,000 for that shit.
Dude, six guys? That's like...
Girl got laid and got paid as a cop, didn't get arrested for it.
Got laid, got paid for that, got a paycheck, and didn't get arrested. So you know every hooker in America right now is like, where do I sign up to be 5-0?
They're like, what the fuck?
Where do I sign up to be 5-0? And the funny thing is, I mean, I've seen pictures of this woman, and this is coming from somebody that, through, previous careers and other things that I've done, even outside of that, has run in those circles for most of my adult life in one form or another. And I will tell you, there are two crops of women that typically chase cops. The badge bunnies are usually the ones that are a little hotter. Then you've got the holster sniffers, which are the ones that are like really into cops. And use it. Yeah, this one was a holster sniffer turned into a badge hoe, and she proved it because she banged every dude in the department and then cried foul and then sued them. And just to make her go away, they paid her $500,000. Every hooker on the street corner right now is like, hey, maybe being 5-0 is not so bad. Let's go figure this shit out.
Well, I obviously, I understand kind of with some of the legitimate parts of Me Too movement, there definitely are things about power dynamics and ways in which that informs, kind of coercion or consent or whatever else. And that's definitely a thing, and I could absolutely see it, in a police department as well. But at some point, it's like, that would maybe be for one or two things. We're talking about, I think it was six different guys.
Yeah, I mean, dude.
And then she even had a threesome with one of them and his wife. Like, that's not the thing. And then she has the audacity to claim that she was groomed. Yeah, she was groomed. I don't really like that being used with adults, adults grooming other adults. I'm not saying it can never happen. But I do believe in the coercion and power dynamic, stuff that can be problematic and particularly take advantage of certain kinds of people. That doesn't seem to be her. Number one, just based on her own social media activity, she seems pretty bold and risque and she bragged about this stuff. This does not seem like someone that was demure and shy and was bullied into this and was talked into it on some kind of level. It feels wrong to use that terminology, but it seems like they just, I think the insurance and the department just didn't want to deal with the shit anymore, and they just rolled.
Yeah, pretty well. I mean, of course they rolled over, and it's always more fun when women are on top. So,
well, anyway. They definitely did that.
But yeah, so anyway, here's my take on all this. One, was she conditioned? Because I don't really want to use the term groomed. I doubt that, because she was trained to kill people in the process of becoming a cop. So if she really felt like she was being abused, pretty sure she probably would have taken care of business, not ran trained like Thomas the Tank Engine. I'm just saying. But yeah, Rex just about killed me in chat, by the way.
He what?
Rex just about killed me in chat, by the way. He's like 5-0, more like 5-1, am I right?
Oh. Well, one of them was even like this dude and his wife, like a threesome with the wife. I'm like, who are these people? What are y'all doing, you freaks? Like, go somewhere else for that and keep it secret. Not within your department, you weirdos. This isn't a frat house.
Just kind of makes you wonder how many of the cops in the department had on upside down pineapple stickers on their lockers. Sorry.
No kidding, man. That is just wild, though. $500,000. That's why I said, like, so does paying her off her sexual activity on the job make her a taxpayer funded prostitute?
Yeah, my answer to that was an adjunct politician. I said that makes her an adjunct politician.
I mean, it's just nuts, man.
I mean, politicians are
nuts. Politicians
by definition are taxpayer funded hookers.
But these days, well, yeah, and if you look at the rate at which they're trying to give away our money,
again,
that is what.
Yeah, for like the millionth time, who I feel sorry for right now is Chip Roy, in this whole thing, because he's the one, like, you know, standing up at the podium right now, like, where are all the social conservatives? And they're all over at the speaker's house having a party. Or on some patio with the speaker having a party. Well, he's like, where's all the social conservatives that are upset about the $500,000 for kids to be put in binders and shit? Where is that? And I'm like, you're unfortunately finding out what I've been trying to tell everybody for the last 16 years. Politics in America has become reality TV at its finest. They get us fighting with each other over the prettily wrapped red or blue packages. And then we pick one, and we open it, and it's the same shit on the inside over and over and over again. And this is why, and this has mostly been on the Day Show, because I have more time to talk about it. I've been going through history and pointing out exactly when this country started dying, which was 1913, by the way. Because that's when they made us the batteries to fund all their bullshit instead of having to do it through bonds. So... so much fun.
Instead of having to do it through bombs.
Bonds.
Oh, man. I know. It sounded like you said bombs, and I started laughing. I'm like, oh, well, kind of that, too. Because
I mean, sort of.
Blew shit up to get everything funded.
Well, I mean, sort of. I mean, that's just like their biggest push for the Ukraine funding was most of the money that we're supposedly funding into Ukraine is going to go back into our military-industrial complex so that we can replenish the stuff that we've already sold them. I'm like, dude, we sent them like fourth-generation technology. We've already replenished it. Second of all, even if what you're saying is true, saying that you're going to give money for that to fund our military-industrial complex isn't the win you think it is anymore, because nobody but the Dems really likes the military-industrial complex anymore. I don't know when that changed, because when I was a kid, it was supposedly the Republicans that were just, they want to fund the military for everything. No, we just want a strong military, and then there has to be a stopping point at some point. We don't want perpetual wars. We don't... Anyway.
It was the norm, like, when they were running against Obama. I mean, it was still... We were the party of war, even then, in, like, strong military-industrial complex, and yada, 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 and Dems were like, no, all war is bad, all soldiers are bad, they're all complicit, everybody's complicit in this weird way in which the Republicans are trying to join with all these other world powers to still try to impress the American will on everybody, and that is super bad, guys. So, like, no, absolutely not. No wars, no military, cut funding. And then, like, 4 years later, they're like, we need a strong defense, we need blah, 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 blah. And you're like, what? I mean, Hillary practically ran as a war hawk. That's crazy.
Yeah, well, I mean, in her defense...
And the Dems went, okay.
Well, in her defense, Hillary was a Goldwater girl in high school, so...
Oh yeah, no, she totally is. In fact, that's something I said back when, you know, her and Trump were running against each other, of course, as I said, I mean, to be honest, like when people are talking about, you know, foreign affairs and in our kind of global security, with her there, I'm not really worried about it. She'll bomb the fuck out of some people. I was worried about all the other things deteriorating within, like, domestically. But, like, as far as internationally went, I'm like, she don't gonna fuck around. She'll drop some bombs. Like, watch her. But that was never, like, but yeah, that was always a part of her kind of deal. And it was part of why she was Secretary of State under Obama. She had that old school Democrat kind of mentality when it came to, when it came to foreign affairs.
Yeah, but here's the thing, right? I'm not saying we don't need a strong military. But what I am saying is we need to start looking at how our current adversaries are actually fighting us, because they're not doing it the traditional way anymore. China has what is called an unrestricted warfare policy, and they are using everything at their disposal. It's like all these little crashes we've had over the last few weeks. Nobody's talking about it, but the reason we've had all these crashes, like Facebook going down, and I've even noticed it, like, when I'm trying to use the apps to get food delivered or, like, groceries delivered and stuff from, like, Walmart and the other places around here that will do it, it'll come across and be like, I'm sorry, our card reader's not working right now. Please try again later. And I'm like, great, so I couldn't even go to the store if I wanted to unless I tried to find somewhere to go get cash first, because I don't have cash anymore. But China is probing us daily to try to figure out how to break into our infrastructure and everything else, and that's why they are finding things that are, I mean, and let's face it, our infrastructure is not very well protected. I heard a statistic yesterday that scared the crap out of me, and it was with the differences between our cyber warfare division and theirs. If we pointed every piece of cyber warfare technology and asset, including humans, that we have at China to try to block them, we would still be outnumbered 50-1. We're losing in so many different ways. And nobody talks about it anymore because we're too busy. I mean, you know, China's not telling kids, you know, if you're born the wrong gender, we're going to help you fix it. China's, like, teaching kids how to box. Russia, same thing. Like, there are years worth of, like, PE in Russia and other countries where kids are, for years, taught the fundamentals of boxing in PE for years, because it keeps the mind sharp, it keeps the body fit, and it's and the scariest thing, and I went into this on a deep dive on the afternoon show earlier this month, is a lot of the transgender crap is actually being funded by Chinese people that we've made billionaires. They're putting their money back into this country to push this alphabet soup narrative onto us because it's so divisive. But nobody's talking about that in China. They're not Putin's not letting kids letting little boys drop their penises off. They're not doing any of that. We shouldn't be doing it here either, because all we are doing is fighting amongst ourselves about things that really don't matter, and eventually we're going to be erased if we don't stop. And the thing about it is, I can't get anybody to believe me. There is video footage that just came out of immigrants storming the southern border, and the Texas National Guard couldn't do anything about it. Except for they could to try to stop them without shooting.
Yeah, I mean, they've been directed not to, but you know how, and you know how every time, like the Border Patrol still does, the National Guard hasn't been able to because they've not been able, they are going to be now, but they're just more being used as a blockade and as checkpoint, you know, further checkpoint employees, so that the actual border control who's been saved, who has been actually trained in apprehension and all of that, can actually focus on that part of the job instead of standing around the border stations or the check-in stations. So, but we know what happened with the horse whip, supposedly, which was the reins. Like, we know what has happened on multiple occasions where, or even when they were like putting up the barriers and the floating barriers in the river, and then these people are trying to go around them and they're like climbing razor wire, and then you see a border agent standing next to someone bloody by their own hand. Like, they did the actions, the border agents didn't do anything, but then the headline reads like how barbaric this is and what these agents are doing to these people, and they make it look like they're mistreating them. Like, these people get across finally, especially those that have traveled up through Mexico and possibly other Central and South American countries, and they are bruised, they are starved, they are dirty, their hair is matted, they've got often have cuts and scrapes and things all over them. They're shoeless sometimes. And so they do look awful, but that's not because that's what the border agents did to them. Just the way everything is portrayed, it's so back-assward. And I love the way that everybody freaked out this week. On the one hand, at first it was like, no, Supreme Court blocks Texas, enforcing immigration law. And then it was like, no, that's actually not the case. And then it was walked back and it's like, no, they're actually allowing for Texas to, I don't know, enforce the laws on the freaking books. But here's the catch, though. Like, we can use all the support we can get from the National Guards, from all these other governors that joined in with Texas to say, like, enough's enough. We have to be able to defend our border. It's our state. It's the United States. But if the feds won't do it, we're going to do it. You know, all that happened weeks ago. The problem is it's like we need the bodies to help deal with the volume and everything, but the actual stuff at the border needs to be done by the Border Patrol. So it really does help to have the National Guard involved to take care of all the other things, so the valuable training skills that the Border Patrol agents actually have can be utilized on those things instead of doing paperwork and standing around stations and having to do all of that kind of piddly crap. But it's just, it's insane what we're having to fight here, and that people are still just so ignorant as to be like, no, this is wrong and you can't do that. And the feds don't want to actually enforce any of it. And these, again, it's kind of like when it comes to gun control, they want more laws. And it's like, the laws that we have are sufficient. They're just not being enforced, or people break them anyways. So we need to punish the lawbreakers, not just write more laws that become, you know, they just become repetitive. I mean, it's just ridiculous to have to continue to say this over and over. And that's what happens at the border as well. We have an immigration code. We have laws. And each state has their own, particularly the border states. And the fact that it is like they're being held hostage and threatened by a presidential administration that is allowing for the absolute just nonstop flow.
Well, so here's the issue. Whoa, hang on. What just happened? That was weird.
Go ahead.
I lost you for a second there, and then you were back again. I don't know. Maybe it has something to do with the storms.
Oh, I don't know.
But one of the weird things for me, right, is the entire gun grabber argument just got turned on its head, because a judge in Illinois just declared that an illegal immigrant has Second Amendment rights. Haven't heard a peep from a single gun grabber. Not one.
Yeah. Yeah. Though all of the 2A people are fighting over it. And the absolutists are saying, well, it's either a God-given right or it's a government-given right. And if it's a government-given right, then it's not both. And the Bill of Rights are supposed to be God-given rights and yada, yada, yada. But that's the right to bear arms. That's not necessarily the right to come into a country illegally and then bear those arms there against those people. That's a very different thing that you're talking about. They have every right to protect themselves, but they don't have a right to come in here illegally and then take firearms and use them in an illegal manner as well. That is not going to be okay. But I was going to say, though, like going back to just like this administration just refusing to cooperate with its own laws of the federal government, and you know, really betraying the American people. I mean, even just it came out like I think today that the DHS, like, because of a failure to file paperwork, over 200,000 immigration court cases were tossed.
Yeah,
200,000 dismissed due to an administrative fuck up.
So what happened was the DHS failed to file the paperwork in a timely manner, so the judge had to toss the cases. You can decide for yourself whether that was intentional or not. I'm voting intentional. I'm just saying.
Well, that's right. If DHS, since you know what the stance of the administration is, and the administration operates at DHS operates at the behest of the administration for the most part, like it just feels like the and in these kinds of things, and then digging into that, you see that this is not that uncommon. It's a fairly regular occurrence. Now, not always in these large of numbers, but it is a fairly regular occurrence that this paperwork falls through the cracks and they just go, oh, well, just too bad. And they don't have to worry about it. They don't have to be there for the hearing. And then now we have to do another one. And now that's not going to be, you know, you never find them again. I just can't get over like how people don't see what a betrayal this is to this population. This is not about brown. This is not about Mexican. This is not about foreigners. This is about the absolute inability to be able to be a sovereign nation and enforce our rules and our borders and in a way that is manageable. And when you allow for this mass amount of, you know, this kind of mass influx of illegal immigrants where you cannot have them processed correctly, you cannot guarantee that they will be seen in court, and you've got all of them saying they're all asylum, so they all have a legal right to be here. The result is just insanity, and it's not just the Lake and Rileys and everything that fall victim to these people. It's the overall destabilization of our infrastructure and the breakdown of our society that happens when you have what is actually an infiltration. I mean, it's an invasion of sorts. And I don't like to use, like, I don't like to get too hyperbolic with the war terms on this stuff, but I mean, it is, and there is a way in which you can absolutely view it that way and still be in support of immigration. And I actually even am probably squishier than most on illegal immigration. I have worked with a lot of illegal immigrants because of the industry I was in. And I have, you know, I have a lot of sympathy for a lot of them. And there are so many really hard workers that want nothing more than the American dream. And I think that we should fix our system to allow them to be able to do this the right way, in a much simpler way, and not as costly, in a way that is safe for them and safe for Americans. That's what we should be reforming. We shouldn't just be saying either floodgates are open or floodgates are closed. I mean, right now, I think they should be closed because we've got to deal with the shit we've got going on that's been so out of control for the last several years. But in general, though, like, I think that, like, that's where the efforts should be focused. But the Dems don't want to do it. And let's be honest, neither do the Republicans. Everybody would rather have this to be another one of those campaign issues that never truly gets fixed, so they can always point finger at the other side and raise all the fucking money on. That's it.
Yeah, no, exactly. It's a fundraising tool, and it's been a fundraising tool for a long time. And when I saw that video today, I tagged everybody I could think of and said, you guys either fix this first by securing the border so that we can take inventory of what's already here. Then we can start figuring out what needs to be changed with our immigration policies and procedures. But I tagged everybody, like the entire Republican apparatus, the entire Democratic apparatus, all of it. I have no illusions they'll actually see it, but I was pissed because that broke while I was on the air today, and I'm like, you've got to be kidding me. I don't understand at this point. I don't understand why we don't have like full on military at the border, full on tanks, planes, all of it, because. Even the thing that set me off was hearing from Mexico, well, you guys do what you want. We're not taking them back. You don't have a choice, motherfucker. We didn't want them in the first place. You don't have a choice. You can't tell us that if we kick them out, you ain't taking them back. I don't care what you do with them. Once they're on your soil again, you do what you want with them. But you try to send them back over here. I mean, this is why I could never be president, because I would have been like, look, we're going to kick them back over onto your soil. If you try to send them back over here again, that's going to be an act of war. And you don't want that, because I've already wanted to basically declare all of your cartels as terrorist organizations and freeze all of their assets and seize them. And they're the ones running you right now and funding you right now. So unless you really want me to do those things, you're going to do what we tell you to do, or you're going to become the 51st state, motherfucker. By the time I'm done with you. But this is why I can't be president. Because, I've already been told I couldn't be president.
I mean, I know. Me either. They take one look at my Twitter history and be like, nah.
Nah, we're good. Yeah. That's actually I didn't tell anybody because I figured out nobody from the group was wanting to go this year. But I did actually try to get CPAC credits. I was denied.
Really?
For the first time ever, they said no because they were dissatisfied with my Twitter history.
Oh, brother. Uh-huh. Whatever.
Because I was.
Well, they've killed it. I think we need to try to make CPAC Texas be the thing because regular CPAC is just dead.
Well, and a couple of years ago when they announced that, I was really trying to figure out how to get credits and stuff down there. Their website didn't have anywhere to sign up for credits, and I'm like, well, how do you? I don't get it. But I mean,
I've not looked into it too much, so we need to do that and see if we can get something going because that would be, and it'd be a lot more. It'd be better located for a lot of people that we, you know, know.
We might even be able to coax the Amish to come out of the left coast for at least a visit, since it's Texas.
You never know.
I think he's afraid to go to D.C. because, you know, he's Amish. I don't know. But anyway.
Yeah.
So one more quick hit before we go. Just because there's one more story that I wanted to talk about it while Hordy was still in the chat because I was going to talk about it with him last night. We wound up not doing a show last night. You know shit's got bad when the Amish are registering to vote. Because
they're what?
Yeah, the Amish are registering to vote, and they're registering to vote Republican, thanks to the persistence. he actually tweeted out the other day that he is currently and this was about a week or so ago that he was registering Amish to vote because there's a whole brouhaha going on between the Amish and the federal government about Amish growing their own food and using whole milk and everything else. And I guess there was an Amish guy who was actually selling stuff to other people. So the FDA said nah. And now apparently he can't sell in-state still because of, I guess, some regulation in Pennsylvania.
Who snitched on him is what I want to know.
I'm just trying to figure out who had the tin can and string straight to the White House, because, you know. But all I'm saying is, and at first I thought it was Photoshop, so I started looking, and it wasn't. There was like a caravan of Amish carriages that were flying American flags and Trump flags. And I'm like, when the Amish have started to concern themselves with the affairs of what they call the English, you know shit has fucked up.
Yeah, something is amiss. Something's run amok. That's crazy. But also, who snitches on the Amish? Come on. It's raw milk, for fuck's sake.
I don't know. I do know that the one thing that I miss was when I lived in Delaware, or as Ordy calls it, Eastern Maryland. There was an Amish family not within driving distance to us that had like a farmer's market, and we got fresh butter there like once a week, and it was amazing.
Oh yeah,
it was amazing. It was amazing. I miss it so much.
Yeah, for sure.
All right. Anyway, so we've now gone about as long as the last crew.
Well, good deal. I'm winding down here. It's been a long week. One more day. I've got a fourth grade field trip tomorrow, y'all. So, wish me luck.
Oh wow.
Yeah.
Good. Yeah. Fourth grade field trip. I remember those days.
It'll be fun. My kid's great. Other kids are not, so they get to, you know. And the teachers like are too wishy-washy, so they always have fun when I'm there. Because I actually enforce shit.
Yeah. Well, I mean, teachers are afraid.
The teachers are going, okay, I'm waiting. Shh, I have two fingers up. Shh, boys and girls, what does two fingers mean? And I'm going, hey, zip it. Be quiet. Did you not hear her? And they're like, oh, crap. Ben's mom. Ben's mom's mean.
Yeah. It's a good thing that the last time I did a fourth grade field trip, a teacher wasn't holding up two fingers and saying, what does two fingers mean? I would have gotten in trouble.
Oh, I know. It's like one is like low voices. Two is like silent. Anyways, it's weird. It's weird. I hate it. It's stupid. It's gentle parenting crap. Anyways, whatever. I just tell them to shut up. And then they all look at me. But then I go turning cartwheels in the grass with them, and then they think I'm cool again. So, you know, they're really easily bribed. I can just give them a Tootsie Pop. And they're like, oh, your mom's the coolest. I forgot she just disciplined me the entire 45 minutes because I'm a little shit.
Yeah. All right. Well, I forgot to load our outro, so we're going out with the afternoon outro. Where can folks find you?
Oh, mostly on Twitter at Jay Homestead and elsewhere under the same name. And always Misfits Politics. And I'm not sure who's going to be running the show tomorrow night, me or Rex, but, you know, join us over there for some fun for Misfit Mischief.
All right. You guys can always follow me at RowdyBrick73 on most social media platforms. You can find me contributing on Twitchy, on Misfits Politics, and the Loftus Party when I have things to write about. Need to get back to that. Last month, I was working on my laptop. Finally got all that sorted out, and then my sleep schedule got all weird on me again. So tomorrow, I plan on making a writing day. Other than that, I'll be back tomorrow afternoon doing the Rick Robinson Show, which is now Tuesday through Friday, 3 p.m. to 5 p.m. Eastern. Then I'll be filling in for Mickey Blowtorch tomorrow night, 8:30 p.m. Eastern, otherwise known as Aggie Time on He Said, She Said. Saturday night off, no juxtaposition. It's our off week. Sunday night, back with America Off the Rails, 10 p.m. Eastern. Then off completely radio-wise on Monday, because that's become my gotta-do-other-shit day, because I've been working 7 days a week lately, and I'm falling behind on everything. Anyway, that's pretty much where you can find me by now, and if you don't know it by now, I'm not really sure you're ever going to know it, so I can't keep doing what Brad does. Brad talks for like 10 minutes to tell everybody what he does. I'm just going to record something at some point and start mixing it into all of our outros.
That is what you should do. Just record it and press play.
But on that note, we've reached as I end the show in the afternoons now, we've reached the point where I have to tell you, unfortunately, this particular show is over.
What? Over? Did you say over? Nothing is over until we decide it is. Was it over when the Germans bombed Pearl Harbor? Hell no!
In time, open all the doors and let you out into the world.
This isn't over until I say it's over!
Closing time.
Well, that's great. That's just fucking great, man. Now what the fuck are we supposed to do? Game over, man. Game over.